Thank you. I'm going to talk about solar fuels, and at the same time, I'm going to lecture a little bit. I do want to convey a bit on plasma physics to you. Sorry for that. But I'm only a professor for 3 weeks now, and I'm having to have to practice lecturing, so this is my first time then. I am at the DIFA Institute, that is at the other side of the campus. And here you see the plasmas I'm talking about. And here you see a plasma that we are using next to a student so that you get an impression of the size that you are dealing with. So it is CO2 plasmolysis. This talk is about CO2, but here we are using CO2 as a raw material, to produce fuels. And the medium that we use to get from CO2, the end product of burning, to again a fuel that we can burn, we use a plasma reactor as a power transfer medium. A power transfer medium to transfer the energy that we get in the form of electricity from windmills and from solar panels. And we use this plasma reactor to transfer this energy to the inert CO2 molecules to produce fuels again. How do we produce the fuel? Well, we make CO. If you have made CO, you have a fuel. You can burn CO. Actually, CO used to be in stadsgas. It used to be a main component of the natural gas that we were burning in our furnace at home. So we have already a fuel when we have made CO. And actually, when we give CO to Shell, Shell has all the machinery in place to produce liquid fuels from this CO. So I'm a plasma physicist, and I'm going to talk to you mainly about this plasma reactor, not about the solar electricity as an input, not about the CO2 as an input, which obviously should come from the atmosphere to make it truly circular. And I'm also not discussing in length what to do with the CO. So two key aspects are here. This plasma reactor, as I will explain you, is an ideal power transfer medium, and I will explain you why in a solar energy context. And also what is key is that this plasma reactor happens to be very well equipped to deal with the most stable elements that we can think of, namely CO2, but also nitrogen molecules, which has relevance in the context of nitrogen fixation or fertilizer manufacturing, but also methane. And then you have to think of applications where you get methane from biogas. So there's now the CO2 benefit when making a fuel with a plasma. It's not in the CO2 that we put in. No, it's in the extra solar panels and the extra windmills that we are able to deploy, to install. That's already at the short, in the short-term future. We have been discussing already, we've seen the example in the previous presentation, where the intermittency is a problem. And if you talk about intermittency, so the fluctuations in the availability of solar energy and wind energy, we always are worried, like, are we producing the energy at the moment that we want it? But actually, in the near future, it's actually more of a problem. Are we capable of utilizing the energy at the moment that we don't want it? So it's when the wind is blowing at the same time as the sun is shining and we are producing most of the sustainable electricity that we can, especially in Germany, this leads to moments in time where we have no use for the electricity. That means that we are not able to benefit from the potential economic revenues on our investment. So if this is going to happen a lot, it means that it's more difficult to install new solar panels because the revenues on our investment become smaller. Another reason, so then making a solar fuels is expanding the possibility to deploy more solar panels and windmills. Another aspect is that once you are able to produce liquid fuels from solar energy, it means that you can produce the solar sustainable liquid fuels at places in the world where sunshine is mostly available, and then sail the liquid fuels, the sustainable liquid fuels, around the world as we are currently doing with the fossil fuels. So we have a means to transport sustainable energy on long distances. And the last important part, and that is going then to the further future, further away in the future, is about sector integration. When you are able to produce sustainable fuels, we are able to basically fly an airplane on sustainable electricity, on wind electricity, as well as we are then able to drive current chemistry plants on sustainable energy. So it's, again, not the input CO2 in this reactor that's going to give us the benefit for the climate. So why do I think plasma is a smart way to produce these liquid fuels? Well, first of all, it's this graph. It's an energy efficiency graph measured in the former Soviet Union, producing CO2, converting CO2 in CO, and they were demonstrating that it's possible to do this with 90% energy efficiency. So this sounds as attractive, not storing energy with 90% efficiency in producing CO. Another attractiveness of plasma is it has a very high energy density. So, I call here the number 30 megawatt per cubic meter. It means that you can think of installing a plasma reactor at the foot of an offshore windmill and then sail along once in a month to deliver fresh CO2 and to tap off the liquid fuel that has been brewed in the meantime. And another very important aspect of a plasma reactor is its simple and cheap technology. In essence, the equipment that we use in our lab is the microwave as we all have it in our kitchen. It means it's very cheap, 50 euros for a kilowatt, and you get a bell and a door for free, so to say. But it also means that because it's so cheap, you don't mind that you turn it off for a large part of the time. That's the same that you do in the kitchen. So not using this microwave to produce fuels is not an economical barrier here. Also important is it has a low inertia. If you turn on the microwave, if you turn on this plasma, it's immediately in action. You don't have to heat it to commission it for a long time. So you can follow the intermittency of your solar electricity. And what's important, there are no scarce materials involved, so you can scale it up to the sizes of the energy market. So what is a plasma? A cartoon of a plasma is here. And I'm going to explain you now the essence, in a nutshell, the essence why this plasma can convert so efficiently electricity into chemical potential energy. The red balls are now the CO2 positive ions, and the little yellow balls are the electrons, the free electrons, and these together form the plasma, so to say, these charged free electrical charges in the gas. And the blue balls are our neutral CO2 molecules. We turn on the microwave oven, and these electrons are going to oscillate following the oscillating electrical field in the microwave. And whilst they are doing this, they will pick up energy and slow down again. But they will also collide with the heavy CO2 molecules. And doing so, it's an effect of the ping pong ball and the billiard ball. You cannot transfer energy directly, momentum, to the heavy molecules, CO2 molecules. But these electrons can harm the CO2 molecule in a quantum mechanical way. They can excite the CO2 molecule. And one of the major excitations that can happen is the vibration. So it will excite vibration. And you can already feel it, this vibration. If you excite this sufficiently, at some point, one of the oxygen atoms of the molecule will not realize anymore that's part of a molecule that flies away. And you intuitively feel it's the most energetically favorable way of dissociating, activating the CO2 molecule. So this is, you cannot transfer momentum to the molecule, but you can excite the molecule. In this way, we create a non-equilibrium, in the sense that the electrons and the vibration temperature are very high in this reactor, but the gas temperature is very low. So you can now drive this dissociation of CO2 at room temperature, and that's where we save the energy, that's where we save the money. We can drive this reaction without heating the gas. So this plasma is a medium to transfer the energy from electricity into chemical potential energy. And now I go a little bit even more in detail. How do we see this? This vibration ladder in quantum mechanical terms is a ladder along a potential energy diagram. And you see here that this ladder spacing is decreasing as we go up the ladder. And that's a nice thing to have, as it appears, as it turns out, because it means that so low on the ladder, we excite this vibration with the plasma. But going higher up the ladder, we need interactions of the CO2 molecules. And there we have advantage of this change of ladder spacing. It means that the higher excited molecule has too little ladder spacing to up-excite the lower one, but reversely is the case. So we see here what I like to say, capitalism in molecular physics. The richer CO2 molecules become richer on the expense of the poor CO2 molecules. And this gives us this net extra motion up the ladder, and this gives us this prospect of reaching 90% energy efficiencies. Now I skip this detail. I simply show you quickly how a reactor looks like in the lab. It's a rectangular waveguide with a tube in there. We produce their plasma, and in our laboratory, we measure the temperature with a laser, shooting a laser through there, and we measure the conversion by simply counting the CO molecules that come out of this reactor. This is how it looks like in real life. The glowing light there is the plasma. And then we start measuring, and what we measure is actually reasonably high efficiencies, 50% energy efficiencies, but we also measure very high temperatures. So this picture that I was sketching you, this is still our holy grail that we are not meeting yet, but we are already achieving really impressive energy efficiencies by the fact that we are driving this reactor very efficiently in thermodynamic equilibrium. So how would this then translate into an energy, into a CO price? I compare it with two CO prices, a bulk price that you cannot really purchase at the market, but we can estimate that on basis of natural gas prices. And this is what you would pay to Linde gas if you buy it in a bottle. And this is what our initial lab experiments show as a price. It seems to be favorably in between. Actually, if we now would take advantage of getting a bit more conversion and a bit better electricity price, we see that we come within a factor of 2, maybe within the current CO price on the market. So you see that there's already a promising approach to storing sustainable electricity into chemical potential energy. So I hope I have shown you now how a plasma can be used at the foot of a offshore windmill to efficiently produce sustainable liquid fuels at places there where the sustainable electricity can be produced cheaply. Thank you for your attention.